Let's not talk about fixed point. Fixed point FIR filters. So what does that mean? So we have got all coefficients. All coefficients are integer. And also the input signal is integer. And the output signal. Is integer. So the question is, when is this useful? That's obviously the advantage is it's very fast. So it's very very useful for high sampling rates, and it can be used. That's an N can be used on small microcontrollers without floating point unit. Without floating point unit. So okay, so what's the So what are the problems now with that? So let's think of our classical problems. Do we have any problems here? So let's think of our classical FIR block diagram. So we've got delay units, and then what we do is we multiplying this with our impulse response here. And then, and so on and so on. And then here at the bottom, we have our summation. And then this is sent out here. So that's our input. That's our output. And remember, so that's integer. That's integer. And now, you know, also these ones here, they're just integer. Yeah, so if we're looking at the H zeros, let's just have a quick look at an example here. And so if we, I've just here prepared here just with the internal Python, you know, library from the SciPy. The FIR win command, just generating a low-pass filter here. And so if I start this here, we are getting a impulse response, which looks like that. And so now we see the problem is here that we cannot represent this as integer numbers. So this is running from minus 0.05 up to 0.20. So this would be just rounded, does become just zero in terms of integer. So these coefficients here, just this h here. So the problem is here. So h is too small. That's obvious because at the end we would like to have a gain of 1 roughly of the filter, so therefore the integral over this here will be roughly 1, and so therefore we cannot directly use this here. It's too small for integer. And so we need to fix that. So let's just draw the FIR filter again here, a bit bigger. So delay here. So these are our coefficients here. and so on. And then here we've got our summation here. And remember, this is here integer, and then the output is integer here. And so now the problem was here that these coefficients are too small. And so what we simply do is we just scale these coefficients here up. Yeah, so we just multiplying these coefficients here h with a scaling factor. So we do something like so h, call this here h nu of n is then h of n multiplied by a scaling factor. So that's our scaling factor. And obviously if we do that, the output will be 2 to w too high. Yeah, so this here too high output. And to fix this, we just scale it down again. So what we do is here, so we add here a division operation, and then this is our output here. So let's draw this quickly here again. So here d, so input is integer, and then here we've got our multiplication here with h of 0, for example, and then here h of 1 and so on. And so that's here again integer here at the output. And so now the idea is that we just scale all these coefficients here up by a certain factor. Scale is up by 2 to w. Yeah, so we have scale all this factor here up. These factors here up, so the impulse response becomes larger by this factor 2 to w. And then obviously the output will be 2 to w too high. And so then therefore, we just reduce it again. So we have here a division operation 2 to w to bring it down to the right value here. And then we have the output here. So simple as that. It's just this is here implemented as a bit shift operation. For those who've been doing assembly language or low-level C programming, know that a bit shift operation is very fast compared to a division operation. So and therefore, in general, this is usually done with powers of 2. So that this operation is also very fast, and that's the whole idea behind the fixed point arithmetic. So the only thing what we need to do is we just need to scale our coefficients up. Obviously, the question now is, what is the best factor, the best factor for W? Yeah, so So what is the best choice? For W, and so we need to explore that. So the main issue is the overflow or the value in the accumulator. So if I redraw this filter here again, so now here we have our h of 0 multiplied by whatever 2 to w here, and then the rest is also done with that here, and that's our output here. Our input here, and so this number obviously needs to fit into an integer, and but this one here also needs to fit into an integer, and this is usually called the accumulator. And so the accumulator is our problem or our danger zone here, because the accumulator accumulates a lot of data here via all these steps here. Yeah, so remember there's another one here, h of 1, 2, 2, w, and so on and so on. And so we have a lot of additions of scaled up coefficients, and this might just cause an overflow here. So and therefore the risk is here. Overflow in the accumulator, and so therefore, in order to take into account of this here, we can estimate how many bits we need. So if we say that's our required number of bits, and the question is, how many bits do we need? Obviously, we need to have at least a number of bits coming here at the input. So let's call this here I. Yeah. So these are our bits at the input. And then obviously we have our scaling factor W here. So there is W. Scaling factor. But then also we have a certain number of tabs here. So when we're doubling the number of tabs, we are also needing one more bit in the accumulator, and so therefore this is essentially our worst case scenario here. So when do overflows happen And this is a non-trivial problem, but also quite a lucky accident, or quite a nice aspect of this is integer. Integer is represented as two complement. So what does it mean? This means that this representation is cyclic. So this means if we have an overflow and it's turned back, then this is basically coming back to the right point again. So we could represent integer something like on a circular path here. So we have a number here. So that's our starting number, and let's call this just m. So that's our integer number m. And so now if we do something like m plus something which is too big, then this will generate a rotation here which goes maybe like that, and we are ending up here. But if we then subtracting this here again, so we have a reading which is too big, then this at this point here we will just moving essentially exactly the same amount back, and ending up here again at this m here. And so that if we are combining this here, it will result in m again. And so therefore temporary overflows are permitted. Temporary overflows are okay. And so that's a very interesting finding. And so therefore, now the formula what we had in terms of the overflows can be slightly relaxed. So how can we relax our formula A equals I plus W plus log 2 N? So if we know that the temporary overflows in A won't matter, so remember so how can we imagine temporary overflows in our FIR filter here? That's a very interesting concept, because obviously this summation here is happening just by adding these h of 0 one by one to this summation node here. So that's our a here. And so what is happening this here is that the idea behind this is that this is happening one by one. So obviously this is done by a for loop. So one by one. So this means that, so maybe we have a temporary overflow here. But this might be just reset by the next addition operation here. So basically fixed here, and then maybe we have another temporary overflow further down and will be fixed again. So the question is, are we so lucky that this will be fixed here just by adding something up here, and then this will be fixed there and will be fixed down the line? Yeah, so. Are we lucky enough to have it fixed? And usually with FIR filters, we are lucky enough to get this fixed. Because remember, how does the impulse response look like? Or essentially, more or less, all impulse responses what we are dealing with in a causal system. So an impulse response usually looks like that. And so then here, the accumulator. Gets larger, and maybe overflow is happening. But here, at this point, the accumulator is getting smaller again. Smaller again, so it's fixing. Fixing overflows. And so as long as the gain of the whole FIR filter is smaller than one, the overflows are just temporary. So that's a quite a nice message here. So this means that our formula assessing how many bits we need in the accumulator, that this here log 2 to n, so can be omitted or relaxed for the requirements of our accumulator. So remember, this was here the input, and this was here the scaling. And so with that formula now, armed with this formula, we can also make judgments how many bits we need in the accumulator.